Welcome to Civic Saturday. My name is Kayla DeMonte. I'm the Managing Director at Citizen University, and wherever you are tuning in from all over the country, thank you. Welcome. We are so glad that you're joining us here this morning. I can see that people in the chat have already started to share where they're tuning in from, so let us know too if this is your first Civic Saturday or if you've been here before and where you are watching from today. A couple of hours ago, this turned out to be a very big day for America, and we are so glad that at this moment in the country, you are here with us to reflect, to get grounded, to hopefully let out some breaths, and to use this moment to spark a spirit of what comes next for us as a community of citizens. This is a Civic Saturday that we at Citizen University have been looking forward to for a long time. Way back earlier this year, when we put this on the calendar, we knew it was going to be special for a couple of reasons. The first is that we are, of course, holding this gathering the weekend after our national election. A long week of refreshing browser pages and checking in with friends and family for updates and trying to stay grounded in whatever ways that we could. We had anticipated that this might be a stressful and challenging time, though we couldn't have anticipated just what this moment would feel like in our country, or that we'd be coming to you virtually. We'll be talking a little bit more later about what this week and this day means and how we are thinking about what comes next with Eric Liu. But let's just say a quick hello in the meantime to Eric and Janae.
Hi, everybody. Hello. So glad to be with you.
Awesome. We'll be back with Eric and Janae a little bit. So the second reason that this is a special Civic Saturday is that this is actually our fourth anniversary. Back in 2016, when we held our very first Civic Saturday, it was thrown together in just a couple of days. The election had just happened, and we knew that our community needed a place to come together and reflect and process and just share. We didn't know how many people would show up on such short notice, but we ended up packing over 200 people into the basement of Elliott Bay Bookstore in Seattle, where we sang and we cried and we hugged and we laughed even. We spent some time thinking about what it means to live like a citizen in a democracy and how so many of us didn't have a place to think about these things together, a place to practice this habit with others. And it was then that we knew that this type of gathering was something that we really needed. So now, 4 years later, we are still going strong. We've held many more Civic Saturdays in Seattle and now virtually. And most excitingly, have now trained over 100 people to lead Civic Saturdays in communities around the country. And our reason for gathering remains the same: to reflect on the American creed and this moment in our country, and to rededicate ourselves to the practice of living like citizens. At Citizen University, our mission is to build a culture of powerful, responsible citizenship across the country. And this gathering, Civic Saturday, we think of as a civic analog to a faith gathering. But it's not about a blind faith in America, rather a wide-eyed, purposeful faith in our democracy and the promise of liberty and justice for all that happens because of all of us. And if that's the case, it takes us coming together in places like Civic Saturdays and other civic gatherings in big groups and small groups to build up our civic muscles together and instill a faith in ourselves and in each other. And on that note, I want to put on this crown. We got these for all of our team members on election night. This represents how we're feeling and what we're really celebrating today. So thank you for choosing to be here with us this morning. No matter where you are, how you're feeling this weekend, if you're excited, if you're hopeful, if you're anxious, if you're exhausted, you are welcome here. Let me briefly tell you what we're going to do together today. We're going to hear some poetry and music. We will reflect with some civic scripture readings. We'll hear a civic sermon from Eric Liu. And at the end, we'll be convening in civic circles, small groups to connect and have discussion with each other after we end this YouTube Live portion of Civic Saturday. You already have that link if you signed up in advance, or you can head over to the event page on our website to sign up and get that civic circle link now. I also want to thank our fantastic partner, Town Hall Seattle, for supporting this gathering. And with that, it is my pleasure to introduce our dear friend, Na Akua, for some grounding and poetry.
Hello, everyone. It's been a journey. So let's begin to breathe before we do anything else. So wherever you are, if you are seated, make sure that your feet are placed flat onto the floor, that your back is straight up if you are able to do so. And we are going to just take in a deep breath in and a deep breath out. We're gonna do one measure of breath, which is called 4-4-6-2. You're gonna breathe in for four. So you're gonna breathe in for four, you're gonna hold for four, you're gonna breathe out for six, you're gonna breathe in for two, and then breathe out. Don't worry, I'll guide you. Breathe in for four. One, two, three, four. Hold for four. One, two, three, four. Breathe out for six. One, two, three, four, five, six. Breathe in for two. One, two. Breathe out. Yeah. You needed that. I know. All right. Before I read this piece, I know that we are in a space where we're like, finally, but there is still work to be done. The piece is called Math Always Wins. Count 11:07:23:40 a.m. 49,416,390 total cases of COVID-19. 1,244,666 deaths in 190 countries. 9,740,073 cases in the U.S. 242,261 deaths in the U.S. It took 270 electoral votes to win. Count. Black bodies. 27, Rayshard Brooks. 41, Daniel Prude. 46, George Floyd. 26, Breonna Taylor. 28, Atiyan Jefferson. 40, Aura Rosser. 22, Stephon Clark. 26, Botham Jean. 32, Philando Castile. 37, Alton Sterling. 50, Michelle Cousseau. 25, Freddie Gray. 20, Janisha Fonville. 43, Eric Gardner. 28, Akai Gurley. 22, Gabriela Navarez. 12, Tamir Rice. 18, Michael Brown. 37, Tanisha Anderson. Count. 365 days, 12 months, 60 seconds, 1 minute, every hour. We are counting on the responsibility of someone who cares about what we have all wrought. May we all become shapened and deeply stirred and take account of our tally.
Thank you. Thank you, Na. I cannot tell you how grateful I am to be here with you all today. 4 years ago, 4 months ago, 4 weeks ago, 4 days ago. 4 years ago, when Eric and I walked down the stairs into the underground reading room at Elliott Bay Bookstore here in Seattle, we carried with us a couple of trays of homemade baked goods for the few dozen people we hoped would show up for our first Civic Saturday, and also a couple of heavy hearts. By the end of the gathering, we felt buoyed by the artists who joined us and the hundreds of people who showed up. As you know, we continued to gather in the weeks, months, and years that followed, partnering with organizations and venues around town and then with our Civic Saturday fellows in their communities around the country. Eric's first 19 civic sermons were published in his book, Become America. And here we are today, Becoming America. 4 months ago. 4 months ago, our lives changed, not just with the COVID-19 pandemic, but also for me and my family. Because I was in another relapse of my follicular lymphoma, and this time there were few, if no viable options left to fix me. I updated my will and other important documents and had some deeply sad, reality-filled conversations with Eric, my daughter Zoe, my stepdaughter Olivia, and with my three sisters in Louisiana, mostly about gratitude and love. Two of my sisters and I have very different politics, and the election loomed large in the background. But our conversations then centered on nothing more than our shared experiences and our deep love for one another. 4 weeks ago. 4 weeks ago, I felt very different than I do right now. I'm sure we all do. I was in bad shape, but I had been granted a reprieve. I had been accepted into a cutting-edge clinical trial at Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center. My own white blood cells were re-engineered to find and destroy the cancer cells in the body. The name of the scientific miracle is CAR T-cell therapy, and it's changing millions of lives. As my cells were multiplying in the lab, I was preparing for multiple outcomes, told to expect the worst, while as usual, hoping for the best. And it seems right now, the best is happening. 4 days ago. We all know what happened 4 days ago. And while the uncertainty of the election has been so stressful for so many, I had been exquisitely prepared to be able to sit with the not knowing, to stay present, to celebrate what seems positive, and to not get too far ahead of myself while waiting for the evidence. 2 days ago, I received the hard evidence that I am indeed getting better. I am healing and will continue to heal each and every day. And with the news that we all just received a few hours ago, I am optimistic that the evidence has arrived that our country is also on the path toward healing. And so our work begins. Now it is time for all of you to share your thoughts with everyone else. I recently saw a billboard that is part of a public art project created by the organization Four Freedoms. The billboard simply asked, "Can we coexist?" In this moment, this question bears some thought, and we want to invite you to respond however you want to take it. Use the chat, think about it, and share your thoughts. Can we coexist?
As we're waiting for some of these responses coming in on chat, this billboard is part of this project that you described. And I was recently in a conversation with someone just about the meaning of that and the different ways that you can take the question. Mm-hmm. And of course, the mind first goes to, can left and right, can Trump and Biden people coexist? But what you're saying just about the CAR T cells in you, like there is cancer and cancer killing cells coexisting in you, right? And right. And it's one thing. There, you are existing. We are coexisting. Katie Wilson is saying we can if we listen. Jen Davison, we can if we recognize that we belong to each other.
Adrian says we have to. Real change takes years. Finding common ground has been my focus.
Donna says we must.
Mary Ellen Wolf says yes, and it will take all of us and hard work to make it happen. Rolla Lewis, do we have a choice? I agree.
Mm, Kathy points out rural communities historically did this. Mm. We need to build an urban version.
Lisa says we have to choose to coexist, even if it's hard or easier to not.
And let's maybe read one or two more. And please keep them coming as these come through. But America was literally born of strife, says John Rossi. Mm. Of course we can. We just have to be more aware and focus on it. And that's...
Read one more.
Regina Best quotes Ram Dass, "We're all just walking each other home."
And with that, it is my pleasure now to turn us over into our friends' hands, the capable hands of our musicians today, Joey Shaw and Raquel Chavez.
And keep those chats coming.
Hi there.
Thanks, Janae.
Thank you.
Wow, it's really heartening to hear all the words coming in from everyone around the country. And also, Janae, what you said, it's really heartening to see your smile in the face of what you're going through. And thank you, Na, for your words. And so we are here to sing an old Woody Guthrie song called "This Land Is Your Land." You've probably heard of it. And when we were working on this song, some questions struck us about, you know, what it's saying, and we just had to really listen to what was new about it in this current time. And I found myself thinking a lot about who is the you and who is the me in that 8-word refrain of "this land was made for you and me." And I think that's important to keep in mind in terms of coexisting, you know. Yeah. And then I also thought a lot about what is the responsibility of acknowledging, of really, really taking into account that this land is for all of us, and what kind of stewardship that puts on us. So, Ben, do you want to?
Yeah, in the spirit of acknowledgement, we're in Fairfax, California right now. We're on coastal Miwok land. And, you know, the refrain of this song, "From the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream Waters," those were two areas of the country that were hit very hard this summer. And it broke all of our hearts, especially over here, and still is a huge concern. So this land is our responsibility as well.
Hmm. Yeah, cool. All right.
So with that.
As I went walking that ribbon of highway, I saw above me that endless skyway, saw below me the golden valley, and I said, "This land was made for you and me." I roamed and by the relief office, I saw my people as they stood hungry. I stood there wondering. to stop me. A sign was painted, said private property, but on the back side, it didn't say nothing at all. That's because this land was made for you and me. This land is your land, this land is my land, from California to the Staten Island, from the redwood forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me. No existe nadie que pueda pararnos por el camino de libertad. No existe nadie que pueda hacernos volver. Esta tierra es para mí y para ti. Shining as I was strolling through wheat fields waving and dust clouds rolling, and the voice was chanting as the fog was lifting, saying this land was made for you and me. This land is your land, this land is my land, from California to New York Island, from redwood forest to the Gulf Stream waters. This land was made for you and me. Esta tierra es para mí y para ti.
Wow. Thank you so much, Raquel and Joey. I can feel the emotion coming through in that song. Wow. Thank you so much for that. It was beautiful to hear your reflection on Woody Guthrie and what those words meant when he wrote them, what those words mean to us now. And on that same note, we're going to now spend a little bit of time reading some pieces of civic scripture before we tee up for Eric's civic sermon. I'm going to read us this first selection here, which are words from Senator John McCain from his concession speech on November 5th, 2008. My friends, we have come to the end of a long journey. The American people have spoken, and they have spoken clearly. A little while ago, I had the honor of calling Senator Barack Obama to congratulate him on being elected the next president of the country that we both love. In a contest as long and difficult as this campaign has been, his success alone commands my respect for his ability and perseverance. But that he managed to do so by inspiring the hopes of so many millions of Americans who had once wrongly believed that they had little at stake or little influence in the election of an American president is something I deeply admire and commend him for achieving. I've always believed that America offers opportunities to all who have the industry and will to seize it. Senator Obama believes that too. But we both recognize that though we have come a long way from the old injustices that once stained our nation's reputation and denied some Americans the full blessings of American citizenship, the memory of them still has the power to wound. A century ago, President Theodore Roosevelt's invitation of Booker T. Washington to visit, to dine at the White House, was taken as an outrage in many quarters. America today is a world away from the cruel and prideful bigotry of that time. There's no better evidence of this than the election of an African American to the presidency of the United States. Let there be no reason now for any American to fail to cherish their citizenship in this, the greatest nation on earth. Senator Obama and I have argued our differences, and he has prevailed. No doubt many of those differences remain. These are difficult times for our country, and I pledge to him tonight to do all in my power to help him lead us through the many challenges we face. I urge all Americans who supported me to join me in not just congratulating him, but offering our next president our goodwill and earnest effort to find ways to come together, to find the necessary compromises, to bridge the differences, and help restore our prosperity, defend our security in a dangerous world, and leave our children and grandchildren in a stronger, better country than we inherited. Whatever our differences, we are fellow Americans, and please believe me when I say that no association has ever meant more to me than that.
Ella Baker, civil rights activist, quoted in Moving the Mountain, Women Working for Social Change, 1980. First, there is a prerequisite, the recognition on the part of the established powers that people have a right to participate in the decisions that affect their lives. And it doesn't matter whether those decisions have to do with schools or housing or some other aspect of their lives. There is a corollary to this prerequisite. The citizens themselves must be conscious of the fact that it is their right. Then comes the question, how do you reach the people if they aren't already conscious of this right? How do you break down resistance on the part of the powers that be towards citizens becoming participants in decision-making? I don't have any cut pattern, except that I believe that people, when informed about the things they are concerned with, will find a way to react. In organizing a community, you start with people where they are. You didn't see me on television. You didn't see news stories about me. The kind of role that I tried to play was to pick up pieces or put together pieces out of which I hoped organizations might come. My theory is strong people don't need strong leaders.
Thank you, Kayla. Thank you, Janae, for those readings of these texts, of what we call civic scripture. And Na, thank you so much for counting, for holding us to account, for voicing that inner moral metronome that has to keep on ticking, even if there's a lot of noise out there. And Raquel and Joey, my goodness, thank you for not just unpacking what this song meant to you, but for singing it in ways that brought tears to your own eyes as you were singing and to our eyes as we were listening and singing along with you. And thanks to all of you from around this land who've come together today, who've come together at this hour of decision to make sense of this moment together and to reckon with each other, to remind ourselves that we're not alone. We are in a moment of peak partisanship, but we have come together today as partisans for democracy. It is as a partisan for democracy, not as a Democrat, that I admire John McCain's example, the words that he uttered on that election night 12 years ago. It is as a partisan for democracy that I eagerly await Donald Trump's exit from the White House. And I celebrate this decision we have made together as a nation to require that exit. But even as I celebrate, even as I take in the sea of emotions, take in the noise, the images, I must now recommit myself to get back to work. And so must we all. I'm brought to mind of what Winston Churchill said after the Battle of El Alamein in 1942, early on still in the Second World War. And he said to the House of Commons, "This is not the end. It is not even the beginning of the end. But it is perhaps the end of the beginning." For us, the same is true. This may only be the end of the beginning. And what comes next is hard and uncertain. Let's face facts. Nearly half of those who voted in this presidential election voted to endorse or to overlook the degradation of the institutions and norms of constitutional self-government, the bigotry of this president, the corruption, the authoritarian attacks on dissenters, on disfavored people, on scientists, on a free press. To ignore or to endorse the sheer incompetence in the core function of government, which is to protect the lives of the people. Why? For what? To get a hammerlock on the Supreme Court, to get tax cuts and deregulation. But let us also be fair and honest. Nearly half of those who voted, voted also to endorse a great push back against the self-dealing elites who have globalized the American economy and eviscerated American makers of real things. They voted to endorse the giving of a finger to a social norm of constant, relentless wokeness. They voted to endorse the end or a stop or a challenge against the free riding of China and our NATO allies while the United States kept the world safe for free trade all these decades. These are real. These are, in a sense, legitimate grievances. We've heard in the last few weeks, over the last 4 years, many variations of justifications for why people who profess to be people of faith, profess to be people of character, why they kept on supporting the current occupant of the presidency. And what we heard many variations of was, I'm not voting for pastor. I'm not voting for teacher. And I started to get a little bit cynical about hearing that until the other day when I heard an addendum to that. I heard someone, evangelical Christian organizer, say, I'm not voting for a pastor or a teacher. I'm voting for a bodyguard. And I thought that was interesting, a bodyguard to protect, to defend, a bodyguard because you feel insecure, because you feel at risk. So let's face facts. There will be more of Trump. There will be more polished and insidious versions of Trump in the weeks, months, and years to come. Why? Because there is demand for more. Demand from many corners in this country. From Wall Street financiers to people in hard-hit communities in rural America. And frankly, to the greater number of African American and Latino voters who showed up for Donald Trump this time than did last time. There will be more. And people now say, even as they cheer and celebrate Joe Biden's victory, that they don't envy Joe Biden. They don't want to have his job right now. But you know what? I do. I want that job. Not the job of the presidency, but the job of citizen. Because we actually have the harder job. We have the harder and more fulfilling job because we have the job of creating demand for something different, creating some demand for a healthier, more inclusive, and more empowering kind of Americanness. And so today, I want to speak in this sermon about three ideas. The first is the limits of democracy. The second is the limits of narrative. And then the third is the power of love. Let me start with the limits of democracy. You know, as votes were starting to come in on Tuesday, saw on a lot of my social media feed of people who are fellow Democrats and progressives, people posting things that basically boil down to, it shouldn't be this close. And now that it's over, people are saying as well, I'm thinking it shouldn't have been this close. And I had this visceral reaction, which has sustained since then. I didn't like people saying that. It shouldn't be this close. It shouldn't have been this close. It comes off as there shouldn't be this many people who don't agree with me. There shouldn't be so many people who don't have my package of priorities, my set of fears and hopes. but it is this close. It was that close. It will always be that close. Because what this election reveals is not so much that we are a divided nation. It reveals that we are a nation of complex, contradictory humans who have been magnetized to two poles in the context of a two-party system with winner-take-all rules, by forces of inequality and wealth concentration that are larger than each of us individually, by institutional racism, by the maintenance of social caste, by our own choices, by our own laziness, by our foreign adversaries, by our denialism, by our all-American amnesia. That's what's magnetized us. In an autocracy, when we look in the mirror, we see what the autocrat wants us to see. In a democracy, when we look in the mirror, we see our full selves, if we have the courage to look, the strength to face the truth, the perseverance to know ourselves. So do not give in to this shorthand, short-circuited thinking that we are now in Trump's America and about to exit it and about to, in a couple of months, enter Biden's America. It wasn't Trump's America, and it won't be Biden's America. The president is not the country. The president doesn't own the country. The president certainly doesn't define the country. And nor, for that matter, do the people who cast the ballots to elect or eject a president. Let's remember, less than half of the humans living in the United States voted. Even with record turnout levels this year, one out of three eligible voters still didn't cast a ballot. And so democracy is about something bigger than voting. It's not just about the casting of ballots. It is about a culture and an ethos. Not only majority rule or the will of the people, it's a web of ways of being, of norms, of what Tocqueville called habits of the heart, of tolerance, of a willingness to respect the dignity of all, to believe in the rule of law, to believe in the idea of fair play, and to recognize that the point of this endeavor is not scorched earth final victory, but infinite repeat play. This culture, this set of norms, this way of being is what all those poll workers and all those vote counters and all those county election officials and secretaries of state all around the United States are trying to exhibit against immense pressure. But it's also democracy, is also all those people on social media, even right now as we speak, spreading disinformation and organizing rallies against phantom fraud and imagining a deep state conspiracy, imagining that Q and QAnon are real things, imagining that I, because I'm a Democrat, secretly want to abduct and then eat your children? That's democracy. A culture of democratized influence in which anybody can shape the story, anybody can spread a meme, anybody can make beliefs contagious. That kind of culture is only as good as the character of those with influence. Garbage in, garbage out. And so democracy has its limits. Let us admit that. Democracy gives us only the chance to be our full mess, in our full complexity, our full stupidity, and our full beauty, our better angels and our inner demons. Not I get the better angels and you all over there who voted for that guy, you get the inner demons. But our chance to see ourselves whole with integrity. I'll take that, as uncomfortable and even painful as it can be, because democracy also then promises us the chance to be responsible for ourselves, responsible for our hypocrisy, responsible for our short memories, responsible for the ways in which we compromise and sell out, responsible for the consequences of our absence. Democracy gives us the chance to remedy those faults, those failings, and those failures. But to get there, we have to learn to imagine differently as Americans. to have a new story about what it even means to tell the story of us. And that brings me to the second thought that I want to share today, and that is about the limits of narrative. The great screenwriter William Goldman, who wrote the novel Princess Bride and then the screenplay, wrote the screenplay for All the President's Men and Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. He has a famous line when he was writing a book, looking back on his career and looking back on Hollywood and the industry and the trade. And what he said was this: nobody knows anything. Nobody, nobody, not now, not ever, he said, knows the least goddamn thing about what is or isn't going to work at the box office. I love that quote because he had standing to say it. He was a guy who made millions on the work he'd done. And even he, and even the people who had greenlit his films, never quite knew what was going to work. But post hoc, after the fact, we make up stories about why it had to be that The Princess Bride would become the cult hit it is, why it had to be that All the President's Men would work out the way it did. Story drives us. Story is useful for making sense, but making sense of things, making order out of chaos, is not actually the same as seeing the truth. A week or two before the election, I saw stories on television about how more Black voters over the age of 65 in Texas had already voted 4 or 5 days before Election Day, had already voted than had ever voted in the state of Texas. And from that simple data point bloomed a story about a great surge, a story about how older voters were showing up, about how Black voters were showing up not only to vote against Trump, but to turn Texas blue. Didn't turn out that way, not even close. Story. You think about the stories that still proliferate about what happened in 2016. Did Hillary Clinton lose because she didn't pay enough attention at the end to Wisconsin? Or did she lose because she said the word deplorable? Or did she lose because the Russians interfered in our election? Pick your story. Or did she lose because she was corrupt, because she was not a skilled candidate, and because she alienated too many people across all sides? Pick your story. Nobody knows anything. Nobody knows anything. Big data today creates an illusion that we can, with very fine-grained detail, find that story, find that truth. Polls try to lead us along to thinking that there is a storyline emerging, and if this election didn't discredit polls, I don't know what finally is going to. But you know what else we grasp onto to make that kind of sense is stories of conspiracy. Conspiracy theory is, to me, always present in the body politic, but it's especially present when a critical mass of people have no idea what's going on, have no idea what's happening to them, have no literacy and power, have no understanding of how their condition came to be their condition, and no idea how to get out of it. And so you will grasp onto a story, including the story that Trump now wants to tell and sell his own diehard followers about having been cheated out of a victory. Story. Tell me why Donald Trump got more of the Latino vote this time. Tell me, in fact, what is a Latino? Tell me, how does a Latino vote? However you try to answer that question, you are telling me a story. And it may be your preferred way of making sense of things, but it is going to fall far short of the complex, contradictory reality. We're seeing this now that it appears that Georgia has flipped from red to blue. We're seeing the narrative emerge, as it started to emerge last night on social media and beyond, that Stacey Abrams made that happen, that Stacey Abrams deserved our love, that Stacey Abrams saved Georgia, flipped Georgia, because of the organizing work she did after she lost her gubernatorial race in Georgia. Stacey Abrams deserves our praise, our love, and our admiration for being a partisan for democracy, for not giving up when she could have given up, for showing up and organizing other people to show up. But this wasn't Stacey Abrams alone, and she's literally the first to say it. This was the work of Ensei Ufot, and the Georgia Organizing Project. This is the work of dozens of others like them, dozens of Black women like them, and dozens of non-Black non-women who joined this cause to tell a different story of what Georgia could be. Who made Joe Biden president? Was it Stacey Abrams because she flipped Georgia? Was it the folks in Scranton and the fact that Joe Biden kept pounding away at being a kid from Scranton? Tell whatever story you want. Or maybe it was the fact, going back to William Golden, and maybe it was the fact that the Wisconsin Democratic Party a couple of weeks ago did an online reading with the cast of The Princess Bride, a reading of the script to raise millions of dollars for the Democratic Party in that state, dollars that they used to get out the vote. Maybe The Princess Bride made Joe Biden president. The stories we tell are just that. And as a baseball fan, I'm reminded of what happens when there's a walk-off home run in a baseball game. And what psychologists call the recency fallacy takes hold. Well, that team won and the other team lost because of the walk-off home run. Technically, yes, in that that ended the game. But what brought us to the point where a walk-off home run would have been the decisive act? What errors, what hits, what great feats of pitching made the difference before then? You'll never know. We'll never know. Why? Because nobody knows anything. The idea that the American people have now spoken, the idea as soon as the election was called a couple hours ago, that the media is already propagating that the United States has repudiated the bullying of Donald Trump, that the United States has given a mandate to decency in the spirit and the body of Joe Biden. This is just a myth. This is just a fairy tale. The people don't express their will. The majority of people who cast ballots expresses their will. And this difference between the majority and the people is one that we as Americans have long blurred. Why? Because we as Americans have long tolerated as the norm the idea that the white majority was the American, that whiteness is Americanness. And we live in a time now, demographically, statistically, psychologically, culturally, where whiteness and Americanness are at long last decoupling. And the irony is that the white majority in the United States, which has always been able to claim the mantle of the people, we are the people, we are the we and we the people, now as the white majority faces relative numerical decline, they're beginning to adopt actually very familiar stances, the stance of minority voice. It's kind of an interesting thing if you're a person of color to watch the way that identity politics is playing out in unspoken and spoken ways among white Americans. 60%, 3 out of 5 white people in this country voted for Donald Trump. Yes, they constitute a minority of all Americans, but they still hold outsized power. And the naming of that power, the reckoning with that power, is what we've got to find new language and new stories to equip ourselves to do. The poet Claudia Rankine, she and I had a conversation. We did an online podcast and recording a week or two ago, and she talked about her new book, Just Us, which builds on her groundbreaking book a few years ago, Citizen. As a Black woman, she talked about how in this new book, Just Us, she is chronicling both micro encounters with white people everywhere and her own thought process as she reckons with whiteness. And what conclusion she came to was that in talking to white folks about white privilege, it's no longer helpful in her mind to talk about white privilege. She's changed the phrasing from white privilege to white living. Let's talk about white living, about people in this country who are called white get to live. Get to live without fear of unfair police treatment. Get to live without fear of redlining. Get to live without the sense that as they walk into the room, they might immediately be disfavored. Not everyone in the United States gets to live like they are white. And as obvious as that sentence is, it raises an even more obvious question. What if all of us got to live like Americans? We can create a bigger sense of us in which white and not white can find common purpose, in which we create not the monoculture of whiteness that predominated in this country for a couple of centuries and more, and not the color-coded multiculture that's emerged in the last half century to challenge that monoculture. What we can create is an omniculture, to be omnicultural Americans, to create a hybrid whole that is bigger than all of this, that recognizes the ways that we have always been entwined, our ideas, our bloodlines, our hopes, our fears, our aspirations, our food, our song. And in that omniculture, we can search out a transcendent reason to believe in each other because we are each other. And that search for belief will ultimately unfold not so much through story, through narrative, not through words, but through deeds, through shared experience, unmediated, not through Facebook, not through Fox News or MSNBC, through the experience of each other. And yes, today we're gathered because we have to, and during a pandemic, through a media technology, but we're seeing each other, we're talking to each other, we are coming to know each other. And when the day comes soon when we can do this again in person, we will do it again in person, just the way we did 4 years ago, that very first Civic Saturday. That brings me then to the final topic I want to share about today, and that is the power of civic love. My friend and colleague Bob Boyster runs something called the Fetzer Institute. It's a philanthropy based in Michigan, Kalamazoo. It does work to try to unearth the spirit level of civic and political reform. And he said something to me a week or two ago that has really stayed in my heart and my head. He said, "You can't love America without loving Americans. You can't love America without loving Americans." That is true, whether your form of loving America is now that Biden has won, you're willing to put up a flag, or whether your form of loving America was waving a Trump flag. You can't love America without loving Americans. And you can't love Americans if you only love some Americans. I was in conversation recently with another colleague and friend, a woman named Morgan Dixon. Morgan is the creator of something called Girl Trek. Girl Trek is this remarkable nonprofit organization that is activating 1 million Black girls and women to find their power by walking together. It can be in marches, by walking together. It can be on strolls around the neighborhood, by walking together, listening to a podcast of something they've created, which is a civil rights boot camp podcast. And Girl Trek embodies for Morgan, who is herself a Black woman, a revolution of spirit, activated by the body, activated by the moving, activated by the sense that when you move, you help your bodily health, your physical health, but you also make possible civic health. And what Morgan says when she talks about the work of Girl Trek is that it is meant to effect a culture change and a revolution in spirit. And so if we are to awaken ourselves to that kind of revolution, if we are to make it possible to love Americans, we've got to learn to resist, especially in this moment right now, after an election has been called, to resist typecasting, to resist making proxies and avatars out of people, to resist taking what you see on a tweet or in a slice of media about this person who believes this, thinks this, looks like this, votes like this. We've got to resist responding to images of people and learn instead to respond to people. Now, Joe Biden's calls already for unity and for healing have led some people on the left to say, screw unity, screw healing. This is a time for retribution. This is a time for accounting and accountability. And this is a time to start driving our priorities forward. This is smash mouth. This is in your face, raw politics. Screw unity. And in that vibe and in that mindset and in that context, it might seem that talk of love of each other, knowledge of each other, that such talk is weak and soft when only power is hard and strong. I say bullshit. Abraham Lincoln knew better. Lincoln loved and he sought union. Bobby Kennedy, late Bobby Kennedy, right before he was assassinated, he knew better. He loved and he sought union between black and white, between the rich and the poor, between the alienated and the privileged and comfortable. Fannie Lou Hamer loved and sought union. Let me tell you something. Civic love, by which I mean loving your neighbor, yes. Loving your opponent, yes. Loving the stranger. Civic love isn't for sissies. It's hard stuff. It's challenging stuff. Civic love is, it's engineering a T cell from your immune system to go in and target and neutralize cancer while leaving the rest of the body intact. That stuff hurts. That stuff is scary. That stuff requires a level of not just open-heartedness and sweetness, but of tough-mindedness, of courage, of perseverance. I've seen this up close with Janae. But we've all seen this up close in every one of our families, in every circle that we are part of. Love is hard. It is hard in the sense that it's difficult, and it's hard in the sense that it girds us. It forms us. It firms us. Love in a democracy breeds legitimacy. It makes consent of the governed real. And compare love to fear. Fear doesn't generate legitimacy. In an autocracy, in a dictatorship, in an authoritarian society, there is no consent of the governed. There's only submission. And yet, dictators and authoritarians and autocrats, they still go through the motion, through the show of having elections in which they magically get 99% of all ballots cast. Why? Because they want to create the appearance of love, which creates the appearance and the fact of legitimacy. One of the people who has very recently gone through our civic seminary program, a Civic Saturday fellow who's now been trained and is going to be leading Civic Saturday gatherings in her own community, as 100 other people already have been trained, and as we hope hundreds more in the coming year will be. We invite you to go to our website and sign up for a future cohort of our Civic Saturday Fellowship. One of our recent fellows, Anchal Dar, during seminary, when she had to write a little practice mini sermon, she decided to make her sermon not just about civic love, but about love languages. Many of you are familiar with the concept of love languages that's used in relationship counseling and just the work of nurturing romantic love. Those love languages are languages of gifts, time, words, acts, and touch. Each of us has different love languages. Each of us responds to different things. Some of us love to be told that we are loved. Others of us like to be shown through acts. Others of us simply welcome the hand on the shoulder, the embrace. Those love languages apply not by analogy, but completely identically in civic life. There are civic love languages that we now need to teach each other, that we now need to practice with each other. And to practice civic love is fundamentally to ask the question, how can I be useful? How can I be useful? This is not a liberal question or a conservative question. This is not a Democrat or Republican talking point. How can I be useful right now? To show love is to be useful. Yuval Levin, a colleague of mine, who is a conservative, he leads a program at the American Enterprise Institute. He had a really wonderful op-ed in the New York Times this week, talking about how no matter who was going to win the president, it was us who had the work to do. It was we who were going to have to learn to take responsibility in new ways. And there was a single question in that op-ed that I want to repeat back to you because it is the question for our times. Given my role here, he said, what should I be doing? And the invitation was, wherever you are, however you vote, wherever you live, however you move, ask yourself every day, given my role here, what should I be doing? And there are three things that we should be doing. First, we should be taking responsibility. There's a cliche that says, with great power comes great responsibility, right? Spider-Man movies, all that stuff. Well, it's true, but you know what? The inverse is perhaps even more true. With great responsibility comes great power. When we choose to take responsibility, to take ownership of the problems around us, we create power. When we realize and say, this isn't someone else's problem, this is mine, we create power. When we say, I am responsible for the health of the body, we create power. So take more responsibility. And in so doing, remember what Ella Baker said, there is no cut pattern. There is no cut pattern. You take the pieces you find. And there is no certain knowledge that the pieces you find and the way you put them together will be decisive. It's unclear whether your acts, your form of participation will make the difference. Nobody knows anything. But it is certain that not participating will lead to things that we fear. Second, what should I be doing? Humanize. Conduct what Claudia Rankine calls close readings of other humans and close readings of your own contradictory heart. The most common question I get when I talk this way about humanizing even those who disagree with you is, why should I humanize or bother understanding someone who doesn't even acknowledge or accept my own existence? The answer is, because you exist. And because doing so proves your existence. There is power in humanizing another. Your own liberation is speeded by it. And you can set in motion a law of attraction, a positive feedback loop of understanding that is a prerequisite for change. And then finally, what should I be doing? What should we be doing? We should be fusing love and power. These things are not in conflict. It's not like we're in a situation where there's a nice soft folks over here talking about love and woo-woo, and then there's folks over there who are getting it done because they're thinking about power and how to make decisions. Love and power are not in conflict. They are entwined deeply. We must seek love and power, power of partnership, power of circulation, not power for domination, for a shared future, not a zero-sum one. Ensei Ufot, who I alluded to earlier, who, like Stacey Abrams, is one of the people, one of the heroes who turned the tide in Georgia. Yesterday, after the first wave of people elevating and putting Stacey Abrams on a pedestal, a second wave of people said, hey, wait a minute, there's people like Ensei Ufot and others like her. And so then Ensei put out a tweet, and I just want to quote it to you. She said, I'm so moved by the outpouring of love, appreciation, and encouragement. We do this for the love of ourselves, families, and communities. And we do this to build power, the power to change our circumstances and shape the future of Georgia and our country. My friends, my fellow Americans, this election makes plain what Ensei is saying, that love and power must be fused. It makes plain the need for an awakening of civic spirit, a shift in our mindset and our heart set. We can choose now, the day after the election is decided, we can choose to sign up for perpetual trench warfare, or we can choose to do the work of what I think not as the long game, but the deep game. The deep game of trying to achieve planet Earth's first mass multiracial democratic republic. It's never been done. Never been done by humans, all four of those. We have a chance to do it. And to do that, we've got to believe it's possible. Because democracy works only if enough of us believe democracy works. And that belief actually cannot be engineered in a lab and reinfused back into us. That belief must emerge from within. It must emerge from our own doubts. It must emerge from our converted cynicism. It must emerge from our misgivings. and it must emerge finally from our free choice. We have it in us to repair the body. Let us love our country. Let us make a culture of commitment to our Constitution and to each other. Let us get back to work.
If you need a friend.
There are clocks everywhere, ticking, 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 consistent in their movements. This is our universal 12-step program. So where is your honesty, 1 o'clock, hope, 2 o'clock, faith, 3 o'clock, courage, 4 o'clock, integrity, 5 o'clock, willingness, 6 o'clock, humility, 7 o'clock, love, 8 o'clock, responsibility and justice, 9 o'clock, discipline, 10 o'clock, awareness, 11 o'clock, service, 12 o'clock. This life is time sensitive.
Wow. Thank you so much, Na. Thank you to Joey and Raquel. And thank all of you out there for joining us on this day through thoughts of love and spirit, through tears, through hope, through counting and holding ourselves to account. It means so much to know that wherever you are out there in this country, we are building this civic community together, and we are all ready to show up for each other here and out there, as Eric said, to make a commitment to our Constitution and to each other. Civic Saturday is not over yet. We hope you'll join us right after this in Civic Circles, which you can find at the link you got in your confirmation email. And just truly thank you so much again to Na and Joey and Raquel for bringing your full selves and your emotion today. To Eric and Janae, to the whole Citizen University team, Tainum and Lorette and Natalie behind the scenes. And let's have everybody just jump off on Zoom real quick and give a goodbye.
Bye, thank you, Eric.
Thank you.
Bye, see you next time.
We love you. We'll see you out there.